Welcome back to No Budget Films, and here we are again with another Byzantine era video. This video will cover possibly one of the most colorful yet controversial Byzantine emperors, Justinian II Drinot Metos, the emperor best remembered for losing his nose and throne, yet eventually regaining both. Now in Byzantine history, Justinian II has become one of the most remembered emperors, not so much for being great, but for being one of Byzantium's most despised emperors for his cruel deeds, as well as for losing his nose and coming back to power with a fake golden one. Justinian II true enough gets such a highly negative reputation thanks to the Byzantine historians Theophanes the Confessor and Nikephoros the Patriarch, who present him as an evil monster, and although he may have done some despicable things as emperor, there were also a number of times to feel bad for him as well, such as when he lost his nose and throne in 695 and his eventual downfall and execution in 711, which he may have not deserved. Just recently, I have finished reading the biography on Justinian II by Peter Crawford, and by reading it, it gave me new thoughts on how to view the said emperor in a different light, thus leading me to create this video. Now, in this video, we will go over 5 times we felt bad for him, and 5 times we hated him for his deeds in an alternating pattern. And before we begin, don't forget to like, comment, share, and subscribe to my channel. The future emperor Justinian II of the Heraclian dynasty was born in around 668 to the newly crowned Byzantine emperor Constantine IV and his wife the Empress Anastasia, and was named after the great emperor Justinian I of the 6th century. Coincidentally, Justinian was born in the year 668, the same year his grandfather, the emperor Constans II, was assassinated in his bath in Syracuse, Sicily, though it is unclear whether Justinian was born before or after his grandfather's death, as his date of birth remains unknown. When still a young child, Justinian had already gone through the difficulties his father Constantine IV faced in ruling a troubled empire, such as a number of military revolts in which all were crushed, and annual Arab attacks on Byzantine territory, both by land and sea. The most important event that took place in Justinian's childhood was the first Arab siege of Constantinople from 674 to 678, which his father successfully defeated thanks to the invention of Greek fire. Although the Byzantines were victorious over the Arab armies, the young Justinian had spent 4 years of his childhood in fear of whether the Arabs will destroy them or not. Additionally, Justinian's father, the Emperor Constantine IV, not only had to deal with Arab attacks as following the conclusion of a truce with the Arab Umayyad Caliphate, Constantine turned his attention north to deal with the invading Bulgars, which ended in a humiliating defeat for Constantine in 680, and thus forcing the Byzantines to recognize the foundation of the Bulgarian state in Thrace. Furthermore, Constantine IV had also eliminated his younger brothers and co-emperors Heraclius and Tiberius by mutilating their noses, which may have also affected the young Justinian. However, this was done also to ensure Justinian's succession, and thus when Constantine died of dysentery at a relatively young age in 685, his son Justinian II succeeded him as emperor at only 17. Immediately after beginning his first reign in 685, Justinian II embarked on an unnecessary offensive campaign against the Arabs, where his armies raided deep into Arab territory, all the way into Armenia and Iran. The Byzantine attacks in Arab territory were so severe that the ruling caliph, Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan, was forced to pay tribute to the Byzantines and agreed to share rule over the island of Cyprus with the Byzantines. With peace temporarily settled with the Arabs, Justinian campaigned against the Slavs in the Balkans and Greece, which he was successful at, and thus he resettled the defeated Slavs in a colony in Asia Minor, in exchange for these said Slavs coming to the emperor's assistance in battle when needed. These Slav warriors, true enough, came to the emperor's service when war resumed with the Arabs in 692. The Byzantine forces led by Justinian II himself and his general Leontios with their Slav allies then confronted the Arabs at the Battle of Sebastopolis in Cilicia in 692, which ended in a defeat for the Byzantines due to the Slavs defecting to the Arabs in exchange for higher pay and land to settle in Syria. Frustrated due to this defeat, Justinian, as said by the historian Theophanes, ordered a massacre on any Slavs he could lay his hands on in Asia Minor, including the women and children. After 3 years of war against the Arabs, both the Umayyad Caliph Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan and the Byzantine Emperor Justinian II settled peace with each other in 688, with the agreement to share rule over Cyprus and to split its tax revenue together with that of Armenia and Iberia. However, not too long after, in 692, war resumed between both empires, and although Justinian can be blamed for restarting the hostilities with the Arabs, he was also provoked to resume war by the Caliph. This all began when the Caliph, who was paying tribute to the Byzantines, not paying the exact amount of gold and not in the Byzantine currency but using that of the Arabs, all while Justinian further offended the Caliph by putting Christian symbols on the coins he minted. In retaliation to Justinian's minting of coins, the Caliph ordered that all papyrus scrolls exported from Arab-held Egypt to the Byzantine Empire have Islamic art put in them, which only further angered Justinian. In response to this, Justinian threatened the Caliph that he will mint coins with words insulting Islam if the Caliph did not stop sending these papyrus scrolls. However, this only led to the said war of 692 resuming and following the Byzantines' defeat to the Arabs in Sebastopolis thanks to the mass defection of the Slavs. Arab attacks in Byzantine territory grew even worse as the years went by. Another highlight of Justinian II's first rule of 10 years was his holding of the Kinesex Church Council in either 691 or 692, which was done for no other reason except for the sake of Justinian having the achievement of holding a church council when there was really no need for one. Although this council did not rule anything significant for the Christian church, it produced a vast number of canons made by the emperor himself, which the people despised, as many of them forbade anything with just a hint of pagan practices such as festivals, theater plays, and games, which therefore made Justinian unpopular among the common people. The one group, however, that despised Justinian II the most were the aristocrats, who he taxed so brutally through his infamous finance ministers, Stephen the Persian and Theodotus. It is even said that Stephen tortured the rich aristocrats to force them to pay such high taxes, which the emperor true enough did not use for the good of the empire, but construct costly and luxurious structures for the great palace, such as the emperor's dining hall. Justinian true enough did not only alienate the aristocracy but the church as well when he ordered the church structure in the great palace torn down to build a fountain, which thus made the patriarch of Constantinople, Kallinikos, never forgive him for doing such a thing. Thanks to Justinian II's harsh taxation towards the rich and his strict religious policy, both rich and poor, and even the church eventually turned on him by 695 as soon as Justinian released the general Leontius from prison, who he imprisoned back in 692 after the Byzantines' defeat at Sebastopolis. When released from prison, Leontius, who here was assigned to be the governor of the Hellas Theme after receiving a prophecy from two monks that he would be emperor, rallied the people of Constantinople to his cause in overthrowing Justinian II. In only a single day, Justinian lost all support and was thus dragged out of the palace by the mob, now supporting Leontius as emperor. All while the patriarch Kallinikos, who also came to hate Justinian, turned on him by rallying more people at the Hagia Sophia, whereas political prisoners too were released. Justinian was thus brought to the Hippodrome of Constantinople, wherein the crowd watched him humiliatingly get his nose cut off. Thus, with no more nose, Justinian II lost the throne, as it was believed by the Byzantines that any kind of physical deformity could disable a man from ruling. The general Leontios thus took the throne, whereas Justinian was sent off by ship to the remote Byzantine province of Kherson, north of the Black Sea. But it wasn't over yet for Justinian. Following his deposition in 695, Justinian II, now without a nose, spent the next 10 years in exile in Kherson, although still determined to regain power. All while Justinian plotted his return with the Khazars and then with the Bulgars, things were again politically unstable in Constantinople. Leontios, the general who overthrew Justinian and became emperor true enough like Justinian, lost the throne 3 years later in 698, following the Byzantines' loss of Carthage. Thus, Leontios, like Justinian as well, got his nose mutilated, though he was exiled to a monastery in Constantinople by the general who usurped him, becoming the new emperor, Tiberius III. However, in 705, the noseless Justinian II, after forming an alliance with the Bulgar Khan Tervel, managed to return to Constantinople, and with the assistance of Bulgar troops, Slavs, and some Byzantine deserters, Justinian managed to sneak into the city using a small breach in the wall where the damaged aqueduct was. As the emperor Tiberius III fled the city, Justinian II thus regained the throne despite missing a nose. And thus for his support, Justinian rewarded Tervel with great amounts of gold, silks, and the imperial title of Caesar. After tracking down and capturing Tiberius and dragging Leontios out of the monastery, Justinian, when watching a race at the Hippodrome, placed one foot on the neck of Leontios and the other on Tiberius' neck as a sign of having conquered both of them for the audience to see. Once humiliating both Leontios and Tiberius, Justinian had both executed, which was thus followed by a brutal purge of any loyalists to either Leontios or Tiberius, who Justinian executed in the most gruesome of ways. Among the victims of Justinian's purge was the patriarch Kallinikos, who Justinian had blinded and exiled to Rome. Now, if you wonder what had been going on with Justinian II during his 10 years in exile, we will talk about it right here. First of all, while he was in Kherson, imperial authorities kept a close eye on him. However, at one point, Justinian began expressing his desire to return to power, and thus the authorities considered having him brought back to Constantinople. Fearing for his life, Justinian in around 702 or 703 escaped Kherson and headed east to the Khazar Khaganate, wherein he managed to seal an alliance with its ruler Busir Khagan, who agreed to provide military assistance to Justinian in regaining the throne. Additionally, Busir married off his sister to Justinian, who when married was renamed Theodora, after the famous empress and wife of Justinian I the Great. Justinian and Theodora were then given a place to live in the Khazar city of Phanagoria, along the Black Sea. However, the new emperor Tiberius III, when hearing of Justinian's whereabouts, bribed Busir to hunt down his brother-in-law and kill him. Busir thus sent two of his Khazar officials, Papatzis and Balgitsin, to Justinian's house in Phanagoria. However, Justinian was already informed of the plot by his wife Theodora, and as the officials entered his home, Justinian killed both of them personally by strangling them. Now betrayed by the Khazars and his own brother-in-law, Justinian, using a fishing boat, sailed back to Kherson to gather his supporters and from there west into Bulgarian territory. While in the Black Sea, they were caught up in a storm, which almost killed them all. However, they managed to make it into Bulgarian territory, where Justinian thus successfully made his alliance with Tervel to regain the Byzantine throne in 705. Although the Bulgar Khan Tervel helped Justinian II regain the Byzantine throne in 705, in return for being awarded the title of Caesar, silks and gold, and some lands, 3 years later in 708, Justinian suddenly betrays him, possibly to take back the lands he gave Tervel. The reasons, though, remain unclear to why Justinian turned on Tervel or vice versa, but what definitely happened is that in 708, both Justinian and Tervel with their respective forces battled each other in Ankialos, in today's Bulgaria. The Battle of Ankialos thus ended with a humiliating defeat for Justinian II and the Byzantines, wherein the emperor barely escaped with his life to a ship headed back to Constantinople, and thus resume a humiliating peace with Tervel's Bulgaria. To make things worse for the Byzantines, the Arab Umayyad Caliphate, now under the rule of the new Caliph, Al-Walid I, resumed attacks on Byzantine Asia Minor and going as far as penetrating into Cappadocia and successfully capturing the fortress of Tyana in 709. Now, if we would come to hate Justinian II for turning against his own ally being Tervel, we would come to hate him even more later on for sending one of his own loyal men to die out of fear of this man's imperial ambitions. This man who had served Justinian was the Syrian Conan, who was a shepherd in Thrace when Justinian met him in 705 on his way to regain the throne. And due to Conan's intelligence, willingness to serve, and ability to speak Arabic and know the Arab mind, Justinian took him in and made him his personal assistant. However, when Justinian regained the throne, he began suspecting Conan of having imperial ambitions, and thus he sent Conan off on a diplomatic mission to Alanya and Lazica in the Caucasus to propose an alliance against the Arabs. Although Justinian's real reason of sending him there was to get him stranded, Conan, however, managed to survive, even crossing the snowy Caucasus mountains, capture an enemy-held fortress, and make it back to Byzantine territory. Eventually, Conan would become the future Byzantine Emperor Leo III the Isaurian, who successfully defended Constantinople from the Arab siege of 717 to 718. Justinian II's brutal suppression of opposition against him, true enough, turned the city of Kherson, where he was once exiled to, against him in 711, wherein its people were supported by the same Khazar Khagan and Justinian's brother-in-law Busir. Although Justinian sent two expeditions to quell the Khersonite rebellion and the Khazars assisting them, the commander of this imperial expedition Mauros and the newly appointed governor of Kherson Elias defected to the rebels, who then proclaimed the general Bardanes, who was exiled to Kherson as emperor against Justinian. With Bardanes now proclaimed as Emperor Philippikos, the imperial expeditionary fleet sent to Kherson thus sailed back to Constantinople, all while Justinian headed east to defeat a rebellion against him in Armenia. However, despite Justinian rushing west back to Constantinople after seeing the rebel ships in the Black Sea, it was too late for him, as Philippikos Bardanes had already seized the capital, where the garrison, who was never really loyal to Justinian, opened the city to the rebels anyway. Before making it back to Constantinople, Justinian was arrested by Elias, who out of revenge for Justinian's massacre of his family, put an end to him once and for all by beheading Justinian with his sword. The decapitated head of Justinian II was thus sent to Rome in Ravenna in Italy, as proof of his execution, wherein the people of Ravenna rejoiced seeing it. Justinian though was not the only person to die in November of 711, as when Philippikos had seized the capital, his henchmen John and Mauros, now serving him, was able to track down Justinian's mother Anastasia and 6-year-old son and co-emperor Tiberius to the church of Blakerne in Constantinople. Despite Anastasia's pleas to spare her grandson, the young Tiberius was dragged out of the church and stabbed to death, thus ending the Heraclian dynasty for good. The fate of Justinian's mother Anastasia and wife Theodora though remain unknown, though it is most likely that Anastasia became a nun, whereas Theodora was returned to her brother in Khazaria. If you wonder why the people of Ravenna rejoiced at seeing the decapitated Justinian's head, this was because Justinian II in 709 ordered a punitive expedition against Ravenna, capital of the Byzantine Exarchate of Italy, which put to death many of Ravenna's citizens. Justinian, sure enough, had always hated the nobility, but he hated the nobles of Ravenna even more for apparently plotting his deposition back in 695, both as an act to take revenge on those who wronged him, but also to reinstate the Pope's authority over the defiant people of Ravenna. Justinian ordered a military expedition against the city, led by the strategos of Sicily Theodore. When arriving in Ravenna, Theodore tricked its leading citizens, who were mostly nobles, by inviting them to a banquet, only to have them all arrested and sent to Constantinople by ship, wherein the emperor ordered them all executed upon arrival. Additionally, Theodore and his forces sacked Ravenna and captured its Archbishop Felix, a rival of the new Pope Constantine, who Justinian then had blinded. With the incident in Ravenna over, Justinian invited Pope Constantine to come over to Constantinople in 710 in order to approve the canons Justinian issued years ago. And although the visit of the Pope was a success, just a year later, Justinian would lose the throne again together with his life. Now, this is about it for this list of the 5 times we hated Justinian II and 5 times we felt bad for him. For the times we may despise him, but also for those times when we come to feel bad for him. This thus shows us that Justinian II is really a complex figure, as no matter how despicable the things were he did to suppress opposition against him and take revenge on those who wronged him, there were still times we may have felt bad for him, even though he may have still deserved these things happening to him, such as losing his nose and throne, having an attempt on his life, and being executed together with his son, which is a rather unfair way to end a strong dynasty being the Heraclians. Now, I would like to know what are your thoughts on Justinian II and whether he was a truly evil emperor with no redeeming qualities, or if you would still feel bad for him at times, no matter how cruel he may have been, or if he was simply painted in such a bad light by the historians who wrote about him. Please say so in the comments. For me, I surely think that Justinian II's evil doings were simply exaggerated by the likes of Theophanes and Nikephoros, but I can still admire him for his strong determination and fearlessness, traits that surely defined the Heraclian dynasty's rule over Byzantium. Once again, thank you all for watching this video on Justinian II, and please don't forget to like, comment, share, and subscribe to my channel, as your support really means a lot.